Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Alliances turn to ban. Dire team pick.
Right, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls of the broadcast here, the Dota 2 Champions League season number 10 action coming at you here. And really excited that you are here joining us on this Wednesday as we got at least five, possibly six games lined up here today, all best of one from, of course, the first round of the single elimination format. We're continuing action. It started yesterday, a couple of games continuing on into today. And we got Alliance taking on Gus Gaming here. Safe to say, again, as it's been the case in really a lot of these best of one first round matchups, you got the team that we know, you know, that is favored. And then we got the other team, at least personally. And I don't really know too much about this Gus Gaming here, but we'll see what they bring to the table. Anyways, with that said, I am Breaky CPK, and I'm going to be joined once again by Tsunami here as my co-caster. How's it going, man?
Reserve time. Dire team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
I mean, that's a safe bet. That's a safe bet, of course. But you know, with that said, being best of one, I mean, this is where the format is a little more friendly for a team like Gus Gaming. The fact that, you know, they like I said, talked about yesterday, you know, if you're a team like Gus Gaming here, I think you could argue, let's just pull off some cheesy strategy. Let's just go for some crazy all-in push or just something crazy. Try to take out a team like Alliance in a best of one. Because if you try to play them at a normal standard game with a standard draft, let's be honest, the likelihood of you coming out on top, not necessarily all that great unless you're just some team that's been hiding around for a while that we just haven't experienced yet. So, I mean, so far they got the Rubick first pick. We got a vengeful Ogre Magi response from Alliance. And then there's the Sand King. So far it's looking like Gus Gaming is doing pretty standard stuff.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Dire team ban.
That's fair.
Alliances turn to ban.
Yeah, you got the core VS, and then you got that mid, perhaps, you know, some bit of a carry that could take advantage, of course, of the physical amplification that he provides, or she, I guess, and that vengeful spirit right here. But yeah, whenever we see the hero, not only for Alliance, but it seems like it has been more of that core hero, especially as of late. The support vengeful days have kind of burnt off from at least my experience. Although I still feel like the hero has potential to be that, but I mean, I guess the shorter range, and I don't know, well, why don't we see support vengeful anymore, you think?
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Alliances turn to pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, makes sense. All right, so third pick. Okay, so there's the Ember Gaia Spirit pickup. Of course, a hero that most certainly can scale pretty well. You know, not necessarily... Go ahead.
Alliances turn to pick. Dire team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Well, yeah, I mean, you, for example, you got a hero like Rubik already with that Null Field, who's going to be Reserved applying time. That magic resist aura, so you could argue right there that maybe that could be it. Yeah, so have we been seeing the Battle Fury Ember Spirit recently?
Meek's assassin.
Alliances turn to ban.
Well, that and you look at this lineup already, talk about physical amplification. You got Weaver, you got Vengeful, of course, for that. It almost feels like the idea of that right click may be the better way to go for Ember Spirit. So, but yeah, we'll see what Alliance decides to do here. They also got the Weaver, by the way, with their fourth pick. So now the lanes are going to be, is this going to be an offlane Weaver, we think, or what? Or a support Weaver, possibly?
Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
So maybe Alliance, yeah, we'll see, but like you're guessing, perhaps more of that support role, and seems like that could make sense for Alliance here. On the other side, by the way, Gus Gaming, I haven't talked too much about them yet, but Juggernaut into Nyx's Assassin now. They got a very aggressive lineup here with their four heroes so far, another fifth one to come. Probably going to be the mid option, I would assume, but so far pretty aggressive.
Medusa. Alliances turn to pick.
Oh.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Medusa, fifth pick. We'll see how that works out for Gus Gaming right here. But of course, that mana shield, important ability for remaining. Such hero. And that makes you wonder if maybe a defusal option here for Alliance at their final remaining. Pick. But really, what do you have, especially for that offlane role? Well, there you go. I mean, Faceless Void potentially could do something like that. And a hero that we have not seen a lot lately as well. So the support Vengeful running an offlane Faceless. A little bit old school here, it feels like, for Alliance. Yeah, it's, when it comes to a history, with these guys, actually, again, I'm really excited when they were announced that they're going to be part of the Alliance organization here and everything, but you kind of nailed it, and I've talked about this as well, that they haven't really been having the success that Alliance, the team in their history, has had throughout history as of late with this new roster. So no doubt, you know, even though this is a quote-unquote smaller event, you know, only $5,000 prize pool compared to others and stuff, they would be happy to win this just for a feel good, if anything, when it's said and done. So no doubt, definitely want to get through this one, of course, and then the rest of the tournament. But it starts here in a best of one. You can never be too careful in a matchup like this, so we'll see.
Yeah, especially if the enemy team wants to try some cheese, they're smoking all five down mid. This is not a Roche lineup, so there's no way that that's on the table. But if they can find a kill and they can give it to an important target like Medusa, that would be great.
Oh, they're going, yeah, right down mid right here. They're not going to be able to run into the Ogre or the Ember Spirit as they go the other way. However, a wraparound here on the potential Weaver or the Vengeful even.
They see him.
They do. Ping him out.
They're trying to figure out the best angle of approach as Rubick leads, but unfortunately Rubick gets a very slow hero with 290 move speed and immediately load of pieces out.
Yeah, Burl Strike level 1, of course, as well, is not the longest range at all, so there was really no way they were going to catch him. Loda was just simply too quick.
Yeah, and as soon as Yonasimfan sees that, he's just like, oh, well, I guess I got a free rune up top while they take that rune. And, I mean, Gus might have to fight for this rune, actually, as they have EGM, they have Hanskin, and they have Loda, so... Yeah, Gus ends up being bullied out of that rune as well, so they might only get one after that invasion.
That's the lack of experience, I think, coming into play for Gus Gaming. You know, if you're going to commit for a kill like that as five, you know, you come up short, you at least have to claim the rune for sure. Because, yeah, as we saw right there, instead Alliance gets three now, and Gus Gaming only gets the one. It's not the end of the world, but not the start you're hoping for. Also, very heads-up play, as you pointed out, too, by Yonasimfan, of course. In terms of
he gets that rune, and he didn't actually place any wards of his own either, so this sentry ward that Gus places isn't going to find anything, though that does mean that Yonasimfan is basically running blind here, as both radiant wards have been basically used to secure runes, and he's going to get chased down in this top lane, but with time walk he's really not too concerned.
Yeah, he's going to be throwing in the air, but again, Medusa not necessarily providing a crazy amount of damage just yet. There's a Pearl Strike fallout. We're going to see that time walk come out right here. Now it's on a 20-second cooldown, but yeah, not going to be able to follow up any stuns immediately, so he'll be fine. He has that poor man shield, of course, and he's going to stand his ground in the lane with those tangos of his. Get that regen kicking in, but they're going to clearly keep up the pressure, so as they should be. Again, time walk still on cooldown, and not going to be a kill, but you don't want to let this Faceless just leech-free experience, so good job at least boxing him out for the time being. Meanwhile, the bottom lane, Nyx Assassin, he's feeling the same pain down here. So yeah, both off lanes, it's going to be a difficult game early on, it feels like.
Yeah, it was a good call to send the Nyx Assassin to this off lane. The high base regen is much better when you're having to go up against this chip damage of Eventual Spirit and a Weaver. So Sand King, while may have been able to get a little bit more out of the jungle by alternating between the lane and the jungle, it's better to have like a competent laner like the Nyx Assassin that can withstand this kind of abuse, as he's taking a lot of abuse now. Nice impale.
I'm gonna stall that abuse, but again, clearly making a point that they want to address him in the lane, but also watching Hanskin rotate to the middle lane on that Ogre Magi is kind of expected, and start to box out Juggernaut a little bit. Also going to cover the top two-minute rune. Will end up being bottom, actually. It's going to be Haste and Maiden. Playing that next Assassin will surely enough pick it up. Meanwhile, speaking of being picked up, Jonathan Fan gets picked up. The Burl Strike follow-up. Fine, though. Time walk away right next to Ogre. And going to use him as a bodyguard and get some regen from him. So, going to get support coming out. But, really the land's kind of being static for the most part, other than the Ogre roaming around right here. Is it... You expect Ogre to sit more in the mid, though? Because he's kind of a little bit all over the place so far.
Juggernaut's a difficult target to go up against. Usually, whenever we see Ogre sitting around mid, it's against very squishy targets, like a Sniper or other ranged heroes that kind of can plink away at an Ogre, but not really do too much damage. And Hanskin's not concerned about trying to zone. He didn't even go for a Stout Shield or a Ring of Protection or anything. He's just trying to find what he can in any lane in terms of experience, or if they can go for a kill, then that's just bonus.
He's standing his ground, he even turns around, throws the club attack at the Sand King right there as they're running him down, but they don't commit to any kind of stuns again, don't want to waste their mana, they understand that they can't necessarily kill him, obviously he is a tankier support. Beneficial reasons of picking up an Ogre Magi, especially for the earlier laning phase and roaming around, but how about this middle matchup, 21 Ember versus a 16-0 Juggernaut, so Limp having the better against Ember so far, as I say that, the spin comes out, but they're not going to kind of zone him out right there at least. But, how's that matchup breaking down? Is it kind of as expected?
I expect the lane is basically even for the most part. Any CS here and there probably just comes down to Limp being... I mean, this is a 9k player that we're looking at on Limp, so I expect nothing but greatness from him. The Juggernaut's going to be able to get anything that he wants as we get a lift on the top lane and a Burl Strike.
Yeah, nice Burl Strike down to both. Now, which target are they going to go for? That's Hanskin, of course. And now Jonas a fan. The time walk, not the greatest distance. He should be fine. Maybe not, actually. Burl Strike on one more second. Going to be using it right here, Shkeeper. And yes, secures the kill. So a 2-0 start in favor of Gus Gaming. But now at what cost for Sand King? Well, it's going to be for his life, most likely. Wave of Terror from EGM comes out and secures the job. And then the taunt on top of that. So at least get some revenge. But you know what, Gus? They're probably pretty satisfied with the outcome there.
Gus is absolutely satisfied. Really nice Mystic Snake by Artez. It went on the Void first so that more damage would come onto the Ogre. And Jonas and Fenn really mispositioned that time walk, because had he gotten it just like, I mean, the max distance, then he would have been just fine, as he time walks aggressively.
Yeah. Oh no, and now Sand King coming in. This is a dead Jonas fan again. I'm not sure what that was about. I mean, he had to know Sand King was going to be coming back any second, and it's not like they were going for a kill themselves. That just seemed like a very sloppy choice by Jonas fan, who's usually a very sound player, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, it's great if you can get like a lucky time lock or something, but even if you do, it's level 1, it's a 10% chance that doesn't do that much damage. You can't really afford to use time walk like that aggressively in a tri-lane situation. It's possible that he thought that Rubick would have left because Rubick was kind of low after that first kill attempt, and maybe they can return the favor if they can get a kill on Dusa, but it's just not difficult to start the gank.
Yeah, like you said, he needs that RNG to come in his favor, but only being that 10%, that's really heavily relying on RNG as far as the jumping in.
And EGM is in vision. He was standing in this nook right here, which is visible from this ward, so unfortunately this rotation gets entirely spotted out, and they're not even going to find the supports, let alone the Medusa.
Yeah, I saw them falling back, and that would be exactly why. It's a good pickup there. They do see that they're doing a bit of the jungle pull. This has turned into a tri versus tri lane now, so Jonas Fan on that faceless, going to make sure to get most of the last hits, or at least as much as he can, while they are attempting to get the experience and farm for themselves. But now being a tri versus tri lane, obviously the Sand King and the Rubick a little more passive when it comes to be jumping in, but that Mystic Snake level 3, definitely the ability to do plenty of damage here and assist some initiation from his teammates. But again, the 3-1 start for Gus Gaming, so this top lane no doubt in their favor. As far as the other lanes go, I mean, obviously the bottom lane is being won by Weaver by quite a bit, especially with how the early game started right here. But Nyx, he's now able to recover. He's level 5, starting to get some levels. But the middle lane matchup, again, continues to be in favor of Limp. So I guess the middle and the bottom lanes are still being won by Alliance, despite what's going on at the top there.
Yeah, but Medusa is really going to be an issue, because depending on how active this Weaver, I don't really know how Lota chooses to play Weaver, because there are multiple schools. Sometimes you want to be a high early active core, and you just show up as soon as you see any window, or you create your own windows to get kills, and Medusa's a squishy target, so if you can find her early, that's great. But if you just want to passively farm, chances are you will lose the race against a Medusa. So hopefully Lotus starts using this good lead that he has against a Nyx Assassin into a kill, and if they can get a kill onto the Nyx Assassin, that's even better.
I spiked Carapace timing right there as soon as they jump him, so it does stun them in return. Here comes him, but he does have an Omni Slash. Gonna use it a lot of targets, though. They'll take up Vengeful, but Nyx goes down so far, one for one. However, Hanskin trying to walk away. You do see Schieffer here on the Sand King, not gonna be able to close the crown as he gets picked up by Weaver, but then so does Ochre Magi. So it ends up being a two for two, with the cores actually staying alive on either side. So good rotations coming out from Gus, at least, especially by the Juggernaut here. And I'm gonna keep the pressure up on Alota. Force into Shikuchi very defensively, but now with Ventral coming back in, careful, and that he will be as he starts to fall back now. So another trade, though, an even trade really of sorts, and again, I think Gus, they're probably gonna like that as far as having even trades right now.
Yeah, unfortunately the Sand King didn't have the mana for Burrow Strike, which is a shame because he actually TP'd onto the shrine. So oh man, mid lane Ember's getting kind of low, but he has a remnant.
Oh yeah, so he TP'd on the shrine and didn't use it.
Yeah, and so had he had the mana for a Burrow Strike, that could have almost certainly been a dead Weaver, because I think mid Omni Slash, Weaver went into Shikuchi and no more strikes was able to get on the Weaver. But either way, a pretty handsome rotation by Imba, and like not even that much damage on the no damage on the mid tower by Lin in the meantime.
Yeah.
Though now Imba might need to be careful as there's an Invis Handskin behind him.
Yeah, that's a little scary. Fire Blast ready to go with that level 2 Ignite as well. So, obviously, if he can get up a good stun right here, a good spin, he'll be fine. But you see Limp making his way back to base, going to Remnant back in, though. And be ready to jump if need be. But with Sand King now nearby, and it looks like Ogre Magi is not going to be doing any kind of diving by any means. So, again, Juggernaut, not the friendliest target to go for, especially when you're heavily reliant on the magic initiation and magic damage in general at this early on. So they choose not to go for it, and instead Imba here on the Juggernaut will rotate into the jungle of sorts, look to maybe find some farm over there. Meanwhile, bottom lane, again, Nick's just gonna be boxed out as man Ember, he's doing this whole jungle camp right here. How about that?
Yeah, that's a nice pickup. They spot out this Vendetta Nyx Assassin, and I don't think Maiden knows that he was spotted by a sentry ward, but yeah, Schieffer's making moves, has 3 points in Burrow Strike. They want to find Limp, who doesn't have any remnants out right now, but Limp is retreating, and looks like this rotation's not going to find anything.
Yeah. There we go. Lota also retreating with the Shikuchi, so he'll be fine. By the way, Limp, he is going the Veil of Discord here, so pretty much answers the question in terms of what kind of Ember Spirit we're going to be seeing again. More so the traditional build of 7.0, but I guess lately you see more of the right click potentially as well. Anyways, Nyx Assassin is going to be jumped right here. In comes the Ignite, and this should be a dead Nyx now. So yeah, big turn on him, the Remnant Initiation. Really nothing more that Nyx could have done after the spiked Carapace right there, so. Alliance.
Yeah, EGM placed this very preemptive sentry ward first to see if Dire had any wards, but then, I mean, you always want to place that sentry for your safe lane carry if there's an enemy Nyx Assassin who's basically getting solo experience. Now Artez rotates to put this lane back, but that means that there's no one in the top lane, and immediately the Jonas and Flan is an opening, and actually Cybernet taking some damage, but he's going to be fine.
Chronosphere is ready to go. Level 7 Faceless Void right here. So, of course, that's one of those abilities that you wouldn't be afraid to use earlier on in the game, trying to set up some kills. Speaking of setting up some kills, yeah, Vendetta Initiation with the impale.
What a crit.
Dead Vengeful. Yeah, a little bit of luckiness going into play, but I think no matter what.
Though I would rather lose a Vengeful if it means that my Medusa is going to get out just barely, but you have to sacrifice the Rubick then.
Oh, another four coming in. Who's that? A Sand King, I believe. He's gonna complete it, but not gonna make any use of it, at least just yet. They really couldn't be jumping in, as you mentioned. Medusa making her way all the way back to base. Jumped right there. She is working on finishing her Dragonlance, by the way, which is just about there, as far as her first time. But yes, looking at Medusa real quickly, what kind of build should we expect to see? Something like a Lincoln's after this, or what kind of a build do you think?
Lincoln's doesn't seem too necessary, because the only thing that's worth stopping, I guess, would be Swap. And if you get swapped, you can basically just hit Stone Gaze immediately, and there's not too much to be concerned about. This game, I think Medusa can pretty much get away with kind of a greedy build. After this Dragonlance is completed, she can go for a Maelstrom. If she thinks that she needs the Mana Shield, then she can go for a Lincoln's if she needs it. Occasionally I see Mask of Madness, but it's not too often. I think it's a pretty strong build on a Medusa, because You can get away with the minus armor and the silence as Medusa because Mystic Shield or Manus Shield ignores all that amplification of damage, and the silence isn't too big of a deal because by the time you want to use Stone Gaze, you'll probably be unsilenced. But yeah, I would probably expect a Maelstrom as they're making a rotation on Jonas and Fun.
Well, they find the jump opportunity. Jonas of Fan, he's hugging the tower. Doesn't see them just yet. Now he will. Can he react in time? No, he cannot. There's the Burl Strike and the easy follow-up. So nobody gets the time lock off. In comes the Epicenter, but big Chrono Spear put down. And now Limp, he's going for their turn. The Remnant initiation on the Sand King. Not enough first damage, though. And he takes the Omni Slash to the face. The Stone Gate is going to be used as well. As Schieffer on Sand King, going to hide in that Sandstorm Darude style. And he's going to be fine for now. Jonas of Fan really wants this kill. He's not going to get it, though. They finally will get the kill after he does fall, though. Now Hanskin holding his ground against him. Loda will port in and look to make some more plays, get some damage out on Emma, perhaps, in the background, who does have that double damage and still activated, by the way, and he's going to end up spinning now as he's taking a lot of right-click damage, though. But there's the swap back in, allowing Weaver to get more auto-attacks off, but he's juking and jiving the best that he can with the trees. Not going to be enough as he's cut down by Limp in the final end of that fight. So, well, what was it, a 2-for-2 in the long run? It looks like it.
A 2-for-2, a relatively even 2-for-2 as well. The mid lane of Gus dies, and the off lane of Alliance dies, and then a support apiece. So slightly in the favor of Alliance, but that was so much messier than it needed to be. Had the Schieffer Sand King just kind of waited a little bit more on Burrow Strike, then it would have been a dead Faceless Void right off the bat. No Chronosphere, no questions asked. But unfortunately, Telekinesis and Burrow Strike were pretty much one for one stacked on top of each other, and against a Faceless Void, every second of disable is valuable, yeah, because as soon as it wipes off, then Time Lock just rewinds all that damage.
Very safe to say, if you weren't aware of why we saw right there in the last fight exactly, you need to make sure. Now, no Chronosphere right now, but it looks like Alliance wants to make a play. They're going to be jumping Medusa. They do not know Nyx is here, though, and maybe even the Rubick. They're going to go for Medusa, but Nyx actually takes a stun initially. Spike Cure is going to be popped over the turn of the Weaver. They get that kill. The Stone Gate's now going to be used, and Arteez still tanking that damage with the Mana Shield. Takes out Vengeful. The freeze on a Limp in the background. Now, he has to run away as him and the Ogre will do so. And I believe be fine in the long run, but again, that was a very greedy and aggressive dive. Not going to work out, and now even more casualties to come, possibly, as Imba chasing down Hanskin. No Omni Slash, though. Rubick cannot get in range of the Telekinesis. Doesn't have that stolen ability to chase him. Oh, no!
Oh, no. Weaver, Rubick earlier had Shikuchi, but ended up opting to steal Flame Guard. He probably was going for the Fire Remnant and just wasn't able to time it quick enough. I guess now he can use the Flame Guard to start mitigating some damage, but man, that's not going to save him from all this physical damage.
I mean, it's, yeah, you're right, it's a lot of physical damage all of a sudden from Weaver. It's like, I don't know, maybe it's fine, never mind. Against that, so. You still get Rubick, but you see the Shrine use coming out right here from Gus, and gonna heal on up, get some more mana, of course, with the likes of a Medusa especially, and really a tank herself with that Mana Shield, and farming the Ancient, so attack. That was a pretty greedy dive, though, from Alliance. That clearly backfired of sorts.
They're letting the Medusa just farm, which is what needs to happen. She doesn't want to have to participate in these early fights, and she's going to be going for a Yasha, which I can understand. Move speed helps out with the whole farming rotations and keeps her a little bit safer. I don't think she'll go for the full Manta completion. She's still kind of deciding how the game goes because Gus is kind of losing a grip on it. Loda is thankfully getting very active, like I was hoping. So the Medusa doesn't have the luxury of just being able to farm mindlessly. She's having to show up to these fights and having to show up to these tower defenses.
Yeah. EGM setting up middle lane, but not going to be making a play as he's going to TP to the top lane. And you see Imba on that Juggernaut pushing it out. Of course, he has his Helm of the Dominator, also going to be going to Yasha. Really, speaking of that, but me and be delayed a little bit as walking this off. There we go. Out comes the Chrono Spear, just walking right out. The follow-up, though, it's a little bit late. He does get the bash at the last second, but no, he's going to be able to spin away and be fine. Meanwhile, time dilation activated by Jonas Fantasy. He's walking away there. Nyx caught by it, so No stun's gonna be coming out from him, but we're not done just yet. In fact, speaking of stun, Shkeeper on that Sand King, he's here. There's a lift. Again, no tackle. Can they kind of stack it again? Faceless. Yes, he's able to get a time lock. Exactly the same problem. However, the Omni Slash this time will finish the job in the end. EGM also going to be spun on after the Omni Slash and taken out. Now, Hanskin kind of left alone behind, but they don't want Hanskin. They want the better target in Loda, who now uses the time lapse and he's going to go the other direction.
He immediately wiped off that dust also. The dust was. They, as a support, you need to decide, is Weaver going to try to Shikuchi out, or is he going to try to time-lapse out? And you have like a split second to determine which one to go for, so he went for the dust immediately. They probably couldn't have caught Weaver regardless, but again, this is kind of not the cleanest initiation that Gus is getting with all these stacked stuns that Omni Slash had to be blown on a target that should have been dead already.
Hey, it worked out. The RNG ended up being in their favor, but yeah, you cannot be making mistakes like that against a solid team in Alliance, of course, and expect to come out on top in the long run. So, just so happens to work that time around, but definitely need to work on that coordination as far as...
Oh, mid lane, Dusa, so low, so dead.
So dead indeed, but at what cost? Well, I guess nothing. Bruce's like, alright, stunned you, now I'm gonna run. Yeah, that was a swap right there to help take him out, obviously. So they catch him as the support happens to not be nearby.
Yeah, Medusa needs to start watching herself because Limp has BOTs completed on this Ember Spirit, so any lane that she... Oh, wow, nice blind slight into Root, but not going to get anything. But, Medusa has to be very careful about where she chooses. Jesus, Limp, what a monster. That Sentry Ward did spot it, but yeah, 9k. And EGM, on the other hand. Oh, tactical walking everyone in? No.
The bait. They saw him going there initially, but they kind of wanted to protect the tower, you could tell. But then, yeah, that Sleight of Fist came out with the Siri Chain. It's like all of a sudden they're rooted, so they decide, all right, let's just kill the target we know that's here. They did. Let me turn off that one.
And now Jonas and Fun might get this tower as him and Artez are deciding who's going to try to go for the deny, and Artez comes out on top. And the blind impale does not connect, but Jonas and Fun, yeah, he's going to be safe.
For now, yeah, he'll be good. What was I noticing? Oh yeah, Shkeeper here, by the way. This is a fun name to say, by the way, though.
I do like it.
Sand King, he's got the Blink Dagger now. Working on the Yak. It's gonna be a while, but of course the Blink Dagger is the priority item right there for him. That gives him now that counter initiation as well as strong initiation on top of that, so good to see. Time-lapse stolen by Rubik, so we'll see if that definitely comes into play for him. But, what was I gonna say about... Oh yeah, Weaver... So he went the Perseverance initially, now he has the Dragonlance, and now he's going to be going the Desolator. So Loda, is this pretty standard stuff here?
For him as a player, I am not an authority enough, but as a Weaver player, yeah, this is just fine. Most of the time, you don't like to have to build a Perseverance just for the regen, but if you're being this active early on, sometimes it's better than something like a Helm of the Dominator, which is typically what we see from carries, but Weaver needs mana regen. Oh, Epicenter, they were trying to go for the read on EGM, but that did not work.
He just walks around the tree like he's somewhere around here.
Yeah. And now the turnaround smoke, Limp, he sees it popped, but doesn't know it's just a Rubik. And so Rubik manages to get away. He should have been dead for sure, but Alliance is like, oh god, the smoke popped, everyone's panic.
Yeah, you can't blame them in a case like that. For us, it looks silly, but exactly. There's probably, they're kind of worried nearby, so it's just, better to be safe than sorry there in that case. I think they did see Vengeful come over initially, and that's why they tried to go for the Epicenter play, but Vengeful reacted just in time. And it made it the Epicenter do nothing in the end, but on cooldown for another 75 seconds. Sand King with that Blink Dagger, gonna have a level 2 Epicenter possibly, or another fight breaks out here.
Oh, and Maiden spots out Jonas and Fun, and he has plenty of time left on this Vendetta, and he's gonna cancel his TP? There we go.
There you go.
Now what happens?
Yeah, it's like, well, you just frustrate him now, because...
Pretty much.
Worth it. Gonna delay the going elsewhere, perhaps farming more efficiently, and all it costed him was just using his Impale ability and coming out of the Vendetta, so not really a big deal, and a minor victory there for Gus. Manta style finished by Juggernaut here, by the way. Chooses to go that in full.
Yeah, it is a bit surprising. I don't really think that there's that much worth... purging. I guess its time dilation is a bit of a concern for a Juggernaut, because as a melee carry, if you get kited, every little bit of move speed makes a difference, and Healing Ward will likely be on cooldown, and Omnisash will also likely be on cooldown, so that's two spells that'll contribute to a time dilation slow, so Manta will be nice for that, and obviously Manta's a fine damage item as a Chrono on the solo Nyx Assassin.
Yeah, now here comes the return plays. As mentioned, only the solo Nyx Assassin, and this could cost him at least
stolen Chrono as well.
Oh no, they got the lockdown limp. He's trying to run away, but he doesn't have a remnant to go to, I believe. He just gets a slide of fist, trying to stay alive a little bit longer, but he'll go down. Jonathan fan, meanwhile, still here, but I don't know, he's in the jungle. But yeah, Chrono stolen as mentioned, so Rubick gonna look for an opportunity now.
Hopefully an opportunity on the Weaver, because man, Stolen Chrono is amazing against Weaver. Unfortunately, there's only one ranged hero that can poke through the Chrono with the Medusa, but that's your carry, so hopefully you can do enough damage, which Medusa is starting to turn on a little bit. She has her Yasha completed. She's going for a Scott, which is a great item as a Medusa this game, because you're going to be able to kite around the Ember, you're going to be able to kite around the Void, and it tanks you up against this minus armor that the Weaver is going to be putting on you.
Is that a bit of a, in hindsight, I guess, is that a bit of a misplay by Faceless where, you know, knowing that you're going up against a Rubick, the idea that you just want to spam Indian's time dilation, perhaps like right after you use Chronosphere, or is that just simply good play by Rubick?
In a solo pickoff situation, you don't really think that you'll need to hide the Chronosphere, because if Rubick does steal it and if Rubick does use it, remember that Faceless can still run around in any Chronosphere. So if Rubick does pop it and you're still pretty healthy as a Faceless Void, then it's not too big of a concern. But if Rubick takes it, steals it, and then doesn't use it, then yeah, you kind of wish that you used time dilation.
I can't say I was I knew that, to be honest. So he could still move around in his own Chronosphere that's stolen.
He can.
Okay.
Yeah, it's otherwise, Rubick would be an extremely hard counter, which he was, because it wasn't always like that. There was a period of time in which Rubick could steal Chrono, and Faceless Void was irrelevant, because every single time Faceless would Chrono, Rubick would steal it and then pop it right on top, and then you're like, what am I supposed to do? Because that was also before Faceless Void had another active spell, so it was pretty much just Time Walk and Chrono, so yeah.
Okay, makes sense there. They're gonna push the secondary tower, by the way, and Alliance doesn't want to get his opportunity
nice
to load
by
himself. The dust comes out. Time lapse ain't gonna happen. Ooh. Oh, it got close, actually. They finished the job, so the Aegis is gonna be popped right
Medusa
there.
Medusa is in a weird spot, and
she
stolen Chrono, as suspected.
Yeah, they lock down the Weaver. Did they have a follow-up damage? They absolutely do. No buyback. Here comes the Chronos from the actual Faceless Void, though, but no follow-up again in our test. With that Stone Gaze, also going to box out the rest, and now Jonas Van needs to run. Us Gaming looking very strong after this fight now, especially taking out Weaver at no cost, really, to any lives, at least.
That was so well played by Gus. So basically, Weaver was shikuching around, as Weavers tend to do, and bumbled himself into a vendetta Nyx Assassin. Nyx Assassin saw his raindrop proc and was like, dude, there's a Weaver right here, someone dust. Weaver dusted immediately, and with this Blink Dagger completed on Sand King, they are immediately able to stagger out the stuff which they had so much trouble with early on. And Stolen Chrono was just the coup de grace on that Aegis life, which was just freshly claimed. That Weaver had the Aegis for, I guess, like a total of 15 seconds before got killed twice. And Medusa on the side, stone gazing, made sure that no one else on Alliance could follow up on that really nice Chrono, but it was a Chrono with no backup damage.
Yeah, we didn't even really mention the Roshan Ko and I were having our own conversation there, but yeah, we see Alliance doing it and then losing it right away. Now, Jonathan Fan. Doesn't know
Omni slashes up. But
run on him. Yeah, he's got that Blink Dagger as this newly purchased item, and they use that before they jump him. As you mentioned, Omni Slash ready to go, but cannot chase him down, so Jonathan Fan will survive for now. How about this Ember Spirit? I feel like, he is 4-1-3, so I guess that is his first death of the game, but overall, it doesn't seem like he's had the craziest impact so far. But I mean, 4-1-3, it's hard to argue that he hasn't, so I guess a little over.
It's the saturation. I guess the symptom of going magic damage Ember early on, if you're not able to pick off get picks galore with this BOT Veil, then you kind of lose a bit of the scaling, because you want a snowball with this. You're mid player, you have items, you're able to move around on the map very quickly as an Ember Spirit, and he hasn't been able to find too much, and so now he's gone for a defensive item in the Lincolns, which is going to be useful against all the Blink Daggers that well, so far, Gus only has one Blink Dagger, but hopefully this Rubick completes one, and then I'm sure as Nyx Assassin, he has one queued up after this Midas as it's the
bottom
bot lane.
Loda just simply Shikuchi away and should be fine. I mean, Shikibra still wants to chase him down. It's still trying to find him, but can't stop him. Back up here, Jonas Zepan, who he's been able to blink away before, but can he actually make his way out of here is the question now. Looks like he should be able to. Unless this impale hits him, but yeah, they're not going to chase him out anyway. So maybe because it's going to stop a TP again, if anything, but...
Possibly. Yeah, this Nyx Assassin, scan used, so Radiant knows that the Nyx Assassin is following Jonas and Fun, but I don't really... Oh, Vendetta used anyway. Nyx Assassin might need to be careful, but yeah, he's going to be fine. It's, the Nyx Assassin went for a Midas because whenever you have a Deuce on your team, obviously you're like, well, this game's going to go late. And thankfully, Gus got away with it because sometimes you need that early Blink Dagger on the Nyx Assassin, especially against such a highly mobile hero like Weaver or such a hero that needs to be constantly put under lockdown like a Faceless Void. But the Midas is working out, Medusa's getting a lot of farm, Gus has more map control than Alliance as they go for this last outer tower.
Yeah, you're right. Last outer tower looking to be destroyed by Gus. Pre-30 minutes, not too shabby, as we're about 7.5 minutes into this game right now. And it looks like it is going to successfully happen. Alliance immediately comes in right now, but that's not going to be the case. They're going to keep their distance, and they're going to allow for this tower to be destroyed. By the way, Medusa here we don't see too often. Let's take a quick look at the talent tree here. 12 intelligence level 10, then 15% evasion from level 15. And then you got the level 20. I mean, you got 600 mana, which is just even more tank or even plus one split shot target. So gonna be fun to see the progress there, but yeah, the evasion no doubt helping this game right now. And they're gonna start sieging now.
It's a long range siege. Medusa does have that Dragonlance completed, and all this chip damage that her Alliance are putting on her aren't too much of a concern, but Gus doesn't have an Aegis, so they can't afford to play too aggressively, because if this Medusa goes down, you lose a lot of the edge that you have right now, because Medusa has plenty of room to grow. There's no reason to play too aggressive, try to immediately start sieging high ground. You do whatever damage you can safely, and then go back to farming.
So if you're Alliance right here, it kind of seems like they are doing a little bit of the split push, and you got the Ember, you know, you got the Faceless, you got the Weaver, all these kind of slippery heroes. Does that make sense? That's what Alliance really needs to be doing right here to get back in this game and try to take the lead themselves.
Well, that's Alliance to the T, though, right? No matter what kind of situation they're put in, they will find a way to split push, because that's the strategy that always excels. And ideally, Loda would not want to have to spend this much time not in teamfights, because he's pretty big right now. He's got a Desolator, Lincoln's, and Dragonlance completed. He does end up completing that Lincoln's after that initial Perseverance build. And again, like I said, there's not too much that he's concerned about blocking, but just one stun makes a big difference, because really, there's Telekinesis, there's Burrow Strike, and then Impale won't proc a Lincoln's, but if you block the Burrow Strike or the Telekinesis, immediately Weaver's survivability goes up big time.
That's kind of another discussion, but I actually, you know, found that out recently, that the idea that an item like a Burrow Strike can be remove Lincoln's or be protected by Lincoln's in terms of it being removed, despite it being more of an AoE stun, but it's obviously the line stun, the fact that it can be targeted. Similar to like an Earth Spike from Lion, I found out. So
exactly, yeah, but that's the difference.
Yeah, but well, then there's an ability like I was testing it. There's an ability like what am I thinking? Spectre's Dagger does not.
Yeah, that's one of those inconsistencies in my opinion, because people will see that and people will cite that, and I have no good explanation. That's just the beauty of the game.
That's just balance. It's like, you know what? We just want this to be this way. By the way, Sanky missing the initiation right there, but he does have that Ags now. So of course that range of Burrow Strike gonna be pretty ridiculous.
Yeah, EGM, I'm surprised you didn't feel more confident about going for a swap on the Medusa, but that's because Weaver's elsewhere split pushing, Faceless Void is elsewhere split pushing, because I think, oh, at the bot lane, never mind, they're continuing. They get a gem on the Nyx Assassin. That's a really big get.
They had a gem on Ogre, that's why they saw him in the first place, and then, yeah, they'll pick up the other gem and possibly drop it off at base, but that's a solid kill for Alliance, no doubt, and a little bit of a misplay by the Nyx, just kind of hanging around.
Medusa needs to be careful. The Weaver's here, and the Faceless Void are here, but yeah, right now Loda's trying to get as much information as possible, but they don't have their gem anymore.
Strat pause.
Strat. What are
something
the strats?
Else I wanted to bring up while we're in this pause here. This is where, what do you think about this change in 7.02 with the shrines? Because this is where you can argue it's a buff. Because here we are, they have all outer towers destroyed. they can't kill the shrines yet because they don't have a tier 3 tower destroyed. So, I mean, it can be seen either way. I get it because it also like you can push one lane and then get that tier 3 as soon as possible and then take them out. But what do you think?
The change was intention to make there needed to be more risk in the game because tier 2 pushes are free in 99% of games and tier 3 pushes are almost never free. It doesn't matter how far behind a team is, tier 3 pushes will always be difficult. And so if you want to ultimately hem the enemy team out of their base, take away whatever semblance of Roche contesting power they had with their top shrine, then you need to put a little work in. And the work is take a tier 3 tower. And so I'm a fan of the change because it means that there's going to be more risky pushes and there are going to be more less than ideal fights happening for the team that has control, because Roche shrine is paramount, because at no point are you ever safe taking Roche if the enemy shrine is up. So I'm pleased with the change personally.
Okay. Well, Gus definitely feeling the change right here, because again, if this was whatever that was, like a week and a half ago, they would be able to kill the shrines right now. But obviously with the changes, not the case, so having to deal with, you know, taking out a tier 3 before they can take out the shrine, so Alliance definitely feeling a bit of a benefit there. Medusa, what is she going to be going for next? It looks like, wow, she almost has it, in fact, a butterfly.
That's surprising, because then she's kind of doubling down on evasion. As we saw earlier, she went for that 15% evasion talent, and butterfly's still a great item for any Agi hero, sure, but still, like, Weaver is not so far behind that MKB Chronosphere on the top lane, yeah, onto a Juggernaut, but man, this is risky.
That's not gonna happen, not even remotely right there. In fact, he's just gonna pour it out. His Jonas Van try to.
Woo!
Whoa, those crits happen fast. Almost died in the process, but get away.
Unfortunately, Omnislash does not have a mini stun anymore, otherwise he would have been able to cancel that TP as well, but yeah, that was a lot of damage and kind of a half-baked chrono attempt, because Weaver was in the area but not nearly close enough to put any damage inside of that chronosphere. So it's a relatively short cooldown. It'll be up in 80 seconds, but I think Guts are pretty satisfied in the mid lane. Blown up Schkeeper.
Yeah, he got spotted by this ward up here on the statue area, and obviously they caught him before he could simply react to swap immediately and the follow-up damage. So good take on a Sand King. He's dead for 35 more seconds, but he'll be up shortly right here. Speaking of, yeah, he doesn't even have his level 15 talent actually.
Oh man, they ported the Nyx to the shrine to catch Jonas and Fun. See where Jonas and Fun's gonna go. Chasing him.
Another blink. Oh, he's gonna time walk and blink. There we go. He just feels it, man. He just knows that it's close.
Nyx Assassin wants it. He has his own blink up, but that means that he gets out of Vendetta, so he's just gonna continue gathering information, because yeah, they still don't have a fresh gem up on Gus, and Vengeful Spirit Ogre is carrying the gem on Alliance. Jeez. Which was that was originally their gem.
Yeah, that's how they saw Nyx in the first place.
Oh yeah, that's time. Right. So then where is the other gem? It's inside Alliance's base. Okay.
Yeah, they dropped it in the base. Whew, that was actually close. The Burl Strike almost hit Jonathan Fan after all that time as he was porting out again. So, but that's kind of a victory for Alliance, because again, he's making them waste a lot of time really trying to chase him down from both the top lane, as we saw earlier, to now the bottom lane. And, you know, it's buying more time for Ember Spirit, who, by the way, haven't really talked too much about this yet, but Octarine Core almost finished and level 22. So, of course, level 25 Ember Spirit. All of a sudden, he's got that the Searing Chain that's nearly 100% uptime, it feels like, the result. So, that's a pretty important level 25, no doubt, compared to others here.
Especially against carry that doesn't really like having to build MKB or BKB rather on this Medusa, which Medusa has a rapier queued up. I don't really think that's gonna happen anytime soon. There are still many, many more items you get on a Medusa before you go rapier at this stage of the game. But
yeah,
that's me intrigued. As they find EGM.
And there we go, Roche.
That's an important, yeah, that's a really important kill, because now this Medusa, who I said has room to grow, also means that she's not six slotted. Oh wait, they're actually gonna give the Aegis to Juggernaut. That's surprising.
Well, I guess the argument is that Artis is tanky with the mana shield, and Ayaskati and everything, and she's going to be from a distance, where Juggernaut's going to be in the front line, so...
True, and the fact that this Juggernaut did go for a Blink Dagger, so he wants to go for very aggressive plays. He wants to basically blink into the enemy base, immediately hack down the Ember Spirit or whatever target that he can get. But, yay... I don't know. It depends on how Gus is going to approach these pushes, because I don't really think they should be starting fights. I don't think the Juggernaut should be jumping in. I think they should just have the Medusa plinking away, because this Medusa is huge now. It has the butterfly completed, has a rapier queued up, but yeah, it's a very large Medusa who should feel pretty safe just shooting a tower from a distance. If you get chronoed, no big deal. If you get swapped, no big deal. As Lincoln's gets popped, Weaver taking quite a bit of damage, but time lapse.
Yeah, time lapse, and he'll be fine. Man, for a second there, I thought they might have had it, but they really just didn't have enough sustain damage there. They do some making a way over, but obviously cannot get there in time, so.
Yeah, one of the cute interactions with the next assassin, which I don't know, man, Shrine TP, they find EGF.
Syrian Chain Cell, rooting, sinking in place. That's how that Pearl
Strike.
Ooh,
that ag range, bro, strike.
Distance. And this should be to EGF now, unless some crazy swap play is going to use it right there. Delayed at least, but yeah, eventually they'll catch him and secure it. In fact, Medusa even comes over. I'll take that last hit. Kill secure. Thank you very much.
Kill secured, but now she has a negative vengeance aura on herself, but yeah, no big deal. They have this Aegis for quite a while, so yeah, I am hoping that Gus will just play it safe. There's no reason to play aggressive. As I say that, immediately Juggernaut blinks to the high ground.
Yep.
They don't have any creep wave. They backdoor protection wasn't even down.
That was ambitious right there, to say the least. It literally did zero damage to the tower.
Yep.
Oops.
Well, we'll try again. Right now, Nyx Assassin's looking for a pick, but their top lane's getting pushed in classic Alliance fashion, and so Artes has to go back.
You know what that was? I think that was an attempt to really just bait out a buyback, if anything. Because obviously, as we saw, she didn't have buyback, but for all they know, maybe she did, and they just wanted her to use it and then fall back from there. So that's the only
possibly
thing I could think of.
But I mean, this is Alliance. This is not some pub team that's going to be like, oh my god, they're attacking our high ground. We've got to panic immediately.
Yeah. So I was bringing up the idea of needing a Diffusal Blade hero, perhaps, and sure enough, Weaver actually does get the Diffusal Blade here.
Yeah, and I'm not a fan because I think MKB would be more useful at this stage of the game, because Diffusal's great, assuming you can ever make contact with the Medusa. And Medusa ended up snowballing much harder than the Weaver, and so, yeah, if you can get a Diffusal before the Medusa gets her level 15 talent, gets a Butterfly, then the Diffusal's a good pickup, but... I don't know, I think MKB is more critical, maybe even something, maybe even something like a Silver Edge or Bloodthorn, either of those, any source of True Strike I think is valuable. Because, I mean, they have a lot of right-clicking cores. Ember Spirit also, if you go for Sleight of Fist, it gets affected by evasion, so Limp might miss with this Maelstrom as Shkeeper gets a kill on Yonasimfon in the top lane.
Yeah, I was watching that. That was just great initiation. Jonas Ben jumped in with the Blink Dagger. No, actually, Ember Spirit runs right into it. What was he thinking about this play? Spike here based on initially. Hankin is here to try to support him, and he will be able to remnant away. But man, that was close. Almost getting the Ember Spirit on top of that. But now with Jonas Ben dead for 30 more seconds, they got a free push right here with no buyback to the top lane now.
And none of the other lanes are pushing, so finally Gus can get the kind of push that they wanted. As Artes, no, they're moving in so aggressively. Just push, please.
Tower kill. Again, they get the tower, you can get the shrines then. So Jonas Bennett, by now they figure he does not have a buyback. He would have definitely used it by now. This is the stun on Ember Spirit. Stonegate's gonna be popped as well. Nice swap out from Vengeful, of course. Will sacrifice herself. But the usual sacrificial lamb play. Hanskin from a distance gonna be stoned up right there, but that'll be fine. And Jonas Bennett is up now though. Chronosphere ready to go. Vengeful staying dead. Villa Discord debuff applied. Jonas Ben looking for the Chronosphere chance. Maybe catch Ember right here. He's going to take a stun though. Melee Rax goes down. And Jonas Ben taking some good damage in the process to get the time walk off the last second. And will manage to live for now. But Ember, he wants that kill. He has the Aegis. He's going pretty deep right here. But he's going to be able to walk it off. Puts the Mjolnir on himself. And he'll be fine. Everyone's staying alive on Gus's side. That's pretty impressive, actually. Although, okay, the Sleight of Fist will connect. Got Imba. Meanwhile, Rubik's actually picked off in the middle lane, and they're going for more with Sand King also going down. So they do get a couple of supports in the long run. But you know what? Gus, mission accomplished with the top rack skill.
Yeah, but structurally, it's not that much more than what Weaver was able to get in the bot lane by himself. A tier 3 of Dire's going down, so both teams have open shrine access now.
That's a good point. Yeah, I did not even realize that. It's such a chaotic fight there at the top lane. But, I mean, that's a conscious decision, though. And I guess with how it turned out, now we got the hindsight here, was that a smart move by Lodo rather than trying to evolve in that fight and maybe get some kills at the base?
It was an extremely risky proposition because if Void died, then there's no way that Alliance would have been able to withhold the rest of the push. Thankfully, Hanscan on this Ogre got a clutch Force Staff to make sure that the Void didn't get hit by the Impale, which was falling up after the Telekinesis and Burrow Strike, so Void stayed alive, and as a result, Gus was like, Chronosphere is still a threat, we have to leave. But still, very, very risky gambit by Lodo, but it pays off.
Couple of pretty big items picked up right there, by the way. The Nyx, he's going to spot EGM again, and follow-up is coming. This should be an easy kill. Yields him, yeah, as expected, the easy kill with that Mjolnir and the crits popping in. And by the way, he just finishes Abyssal Blade.
In the top lane, items. They're going in on Shkeeper. They don't have any detection for him, though, because it's two carries. In comes the Ogre with the gem, though.
Yeah, there we go. So they are going to get him now, but that could have been embarrassing if he was able to stun away and make his getaway as a result, but... At least they secure the call on him. He does have a buyback if necessary. So now we got the game of chicken here. Who's going to push the base?
Artez's BOTs. Lodo does not. Jonas and Thon does not. Everyone has TPs in general, but yeah, Artez goes back. And now he can bother Lodo as the rest of his team tries to push bot, but now they need to be careful.
Can't really stop the TPs,
though.
Oh,
man. Imba Blink. Nice Carapace stun on the Ember.
Yeah, walks right in. Well played. Remnant used by Limp, but not going to be able to chase him. They do not lose any casualties as a result of that. So, yeah, overall, nice delay there by Gus. And, again, find more time for Medusa to... What is she getting, by the way? She's 32, and she is going the Divine Rapier. Oh, my gosh. Like, that seems so unnecessary. Like, has she even died yet, to be fair?
She's died once, but that was very early on.
I mean, but it really just seems unnecessary, though. It's like, what if you happen to die in a big fight? You're giving the team, when you have an advantage, it feels like. I mean, the Necrav even says that, like, this over MKB. I mean, it just feels so weird.
Well, there are many other items that she could go. She could finish off the Pyke, which isn't entirely necessary. Yes, with the Demon Edge, she could go for MKB. She could go for Daedalus, both of which are fine items. I'm going to do Chronosphere.
Well, speaking of dying, doesn't have it just yet, so gonna be caught in the Chrono Spirit, but again, look at how tanky he is. Ember Spirit even falls out with a split shot effect now coming to Evan's head in the background. Down goes Jonas the Fan. And now Limp realizing this is not gonna work too well. Stone Gates will stun him. Hanskin trying to assist. A defensive Chrono Spear coming out from Rubick. Meanwhile, swap in from Vengeful is gonna not save Limp in the end as he's still got caught by the stuns. Now EGM also gonna fall. Weaver thrown up in the air meanwhile. Be trying to be slippery and get on out of here. No time lapse though. We're trying to run him down. Imba blinks and gets the kill. That's a complete cleanup for Gus Gaming. A double kill comes out for Imba, and the buybacks are going to be forced now. Gus Gaming though, they're in total control now if they weren't already.
Artez doesn't have a mana shield though, so it's a bit of a risky push, especially as the third and last buyback of Lodo kind of secures the fact that yeah, you're not going to. Oh man, she's walking to the secret shop. Is she good? She did it.
The Divine Rape. You know what? After that last fight and seeing what it did
right
there.
You know, you earned it. Especially, okay, they have an Aegis potential. Is Medusa gonna go for it, or are they really, really that confident? Okay,
you
thank
have a
God.
Divine Rapier, you give it to I swear to God, if they do not give it to Medusa, they deserve to lose this game, frankly. I'm gonna say that, like, don't do this, man. You're on the verge of beating a team in Alliance. There you go. Okay, yeah, let's play smart.
Alright, well, yeah, I know. She survived the onslaught, and this is the problem from the draft, is that, really, Alliance does not have the easiest time burning through a farmed Dusa. It's just, you were hoping that she wouldn't reach this point, and I would never go Rapier if I'm playing against any professional team whatsoever, but... You know, whatever. She's pretty unkillable.
Artez has some cojones, I'll say that. Definitely a greedy and ballsy pickup here. But you know what? Again, as we saw that last fight, and now with the Aegis on top of that, I'll tell you this. I mean, her damage output is going to be absolutely insane, of course, as... Oh, Cybernet got picked off.
Yeah, he was just trying to play some wards. He got sniped out by the Weaver, which that's going to be one of his last kills as EGM. Classic EGM. Oh, nice Lotus.
Nice Lotus indeed. Actually stuns himself as a result. The damage coming in from Lota, though, will get the kill on the Sand King. But now Lota could be in some trouble. They do chase down the Vengeful. Needs to get out that time lapse. Oh, the nice Lotus Spear attempt to save, but it's not enough in the end. Down goes Weaver. And now Shadow Span trying to get some enough damage out onto the Nyx at least. But again, Medusa still standing here with that Divine Rapier. Remember, dropping about 3/4 of his life, a limp. No way he's going to win that fight. He needs to start backing off now, most likely, as Stonegate still ready to be used.
Void wants to come back. He has all of his HP now, and they're stalling out this Medusa who keeps getting rooted. Oh, but Ember backs off. Well, Ember has that 25 root, so he can perma-root.
Yeah, that's I was just about to say. Obviously, the level 25 kicking in right there, but in our test, more than tanky enough, not enough damage to commit, and even with the two only being alive, and it's Juggernaut and Medusa, so.
Yeah, and Weaver was dead. If Weaver was up, or rather, if it was Weaver and the Void, or Weaver and the Ember, then they would have gone for it. But between Void, who has gone mostly a utility build, and the Ember that has gone mostly a magic build, it's difficult to burn through. Medusa is now she's 2v1ing. And
pushing by yourself, I mean, I guess again, the Weaver is still dead and not buying back in this case. But man, this guy is just playing so ballsy with the Divine Rapier especially. But again, Medusa is a hero at this point in the game, as you talk about. In fact, got level 25 talent herself with 25% lifesteal. So even more survivability worth pointing out now that she is level 25 herself. And especially with that Divine Rapier, that's actually kind of some nice synergy kicking in. I mean, the likelihood of them actually committing enough damage to get this kill, it is highly unlikely unless they just 5v1 her essentially at this point, so.
I like how she's burning through literally every shrine in her base because she has 2.2k mana, went for the 600 mana talent at level 20, and so, yeah, between HP and mana, there's so much effective HP on this Medusa. That's just one life. They managed to burn through the Aegis, which is kind of ticking down, has around 2 more minutes left on it, and so hopefully Gust won't overplay their hand and will go for a push at this point.
Orchid onto Jonathan Fan. Nice, follow-up initiation tool, but is it too little too late is the question. Now, again, they only have the one Raxus story, so not to get too ahead of ourselves right here, but here we go with the Aegis Divine Rapier push from Medusa.
It's a wraparound by Alliance. They're all smoked up.
On a big chance right here with the Chronosphere. Rubik doesn't have an ability stolen just yet. Here in the background, they do catch, actually, Sand King catches Limp initially. Chronosphere in the background catches a couple of Rubik being one of the targets, but Ember Spirit's gonna fall. No, buyback, 120 seconds. He's gonna be dead. Meanwhile, Weaver was locked down, pops the time lapse, now going after Imba, but Imba at half life gonna start spinning, and Weaver has to make the way out of it. That's extra Shikuchi speed as a result of being level 20 for ourselves. So Spike Kirby's done, though, and that's enough lock, and that could do it in favor of Gust Gaming over Alliance. A best of one. It looks like Alliance gonna drop here in the first round. Know what we talked about. This is a format that's gonna favor teams like Gust Gaming, honestly, because they have nothing to lose. They're expected to lose against a team like Alliance, and they come in here and they say, nah, we're gonna win this game. Find some ballsy plays across the board. GG, well played. Gust Gaming beats Alliance. I did not think I'd be saying that.
You gotta roll the dice, I guess, if you're one of these open qualifier teams, and what better way than a 40-minute Dusa Rapier. Well played by Gus. I initially was skeptical. Their coordination on some of the Void ganks were a little bit off, and their positioning had some questionable issues, but mid-game, late-game, they pulled it together beautifully, and Alliance's draft just was not equipped for a Dusa that gets this large.